Welcome to the Epilepsy Foundation's videos on epilepsy and cannabis. Cannabis, also known as cannabidiol, CBD, for treating epilepsy has been a topic of interest for a number of years. The Epilepsy Foundation developed this peer-to-peer education for healthcare providers about CBD and epilepsy to provide important factual information and dispel myths and misperceptions about this topic. Recently, a purified pharmaceutical form of CBD was tested, like other prescription medications, for two forms of severe epilepsy, Dravet syndrome and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. Both syndromes start in childhood and are associated with very difficult-to-control seizures, multiple seizure types, and other developmental problems that can progressively worsen. These videos were designed to share what we know, what we don't know about CBD and epilepsy, and includes published data on the first FDA-approved CBD product for treatment of Dravet and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. The participants share their knowledge and experiences about what to consider about CBD in general and tips for counseling people with epilepsy and families. The project was funded in part by Greenwich Biosciences. The Epilepsy Foundation editorial board of epilepsy.com and staff had complete control on the creation and review of this content.
Hi, I'm Dr. Joe Sirven. I'm editor-in-chief of epilepsy.com, and welcome to the Epilepsy Foundation discussion on cannabidiol for epilepsy. I have several friends and colleagues who are joining me today. I'm going to let them introduce themselves, and I'll start over here, Anup.
Hi, I'm Anup Patel, section chief of neurology at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio. I'm also the medical cannabis editor for epilepsy.com.
Barry.
Hi, I'm Barry Gidal. I'm a professor of pharmacy at University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I'm the co-editor of the medication section of epilepsy.com.
Alice.
Hello, I'm Alice Mead. I'm the head of U.S. Public Policy and Public Affairs for Greenwich Biosciences.
Abbey.
Hi, I'm Abbey Roudebush, Government Relations Manager at the Epilepsy Foundation.
We're going to be focusing our discussion now on how did we get here? The history of cannabis, and also a quick primer on terminology. So to kind of get us started, and I'm going to turn to Anup now, maybe can you give us a sense of just some of the preliminary information that kind of got us down this road?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest misconceptions around this area is that this is a relatively new movement, or in the last few years it's really gotten out there. This is actually a talking about cannabis or cannabis-related products that could be beneficial for people who have epilepsy or seizures is really a topic that's been going on since the dawn of time. You know, there are actual records in Egyptian scrolls of the use of marijuana to treat medical illness. So it dates all the way back there. In our world of neurology and seizures, I think what's interesting is there's some record of one of our most well-known members in neurology, Dr. Gowers, and him using this to treat people who've had seizures. And then, you know, I have this kind of lapse that occurs. And it's not that the lapse meant nobody was doing anything. There was a lot of work that was undergoing as it relates to CBD, marijuana, cannabis, et cetera, for seizures and even in other disease states. But then it was really of recent times when documentaries were started to be made around, you know, this topic. One was on CNN by Dr. Sanjay Gupta that talked about a young girl who had benefited from a strain of marijuana that had a higher content of CBD.
You know, one of the things that the career and profession of epilepsy has taught me is that language is everything. The term seizure disorder, epilepsy, seizure. And in this particular area of therapy, there are a lot of terms that are floating around that I think to some degree can confuse the viewers out there. So I was wondering maybe we could kind of go around and take a couple of these terms that we hear and maybe define them and kind of just give an answer as to what exactly does this mean when we're talking about it.
Well, I think, you know, where this really started with marijuana, and I think then the term that's evolved over the years has been, we've added the term medical in front of it, medical right. marijuana. Now, I think where this does add confusion at this point, where we're at with our understanding of the sciences, you know, remembering that the cannabis plant is a very complex plant that contains a lot of these cannabinoids and a lot of other chemicals. By calling it medical marijuana, I think leads some to believe it's one thing.
Right.
It's one drug. And that's really not the case. And there's a number of these different drugs. They may or may not interact with each other. We simply don't know. And I think that does add to the confusion. So I think perhaps we've gotten to the point we should evolve past using medical marijuana as a legitimate term and start talking about the molecules, just like we would with any other drug.
That makes
we talk about individual molecules.
It makes perfect sense. And I'm going to take a riff off your answer there, because you mentioned two specific acronyms in there. And maybe we can kind of get those nicely defined so that everyone feels very comfortable. And I'm going to look to Abby and to Anup. CBD, THC. Mm-hmm. Either one, that whoever wants to take it first.
Well, I'll take the THC part. I think that one of the things we know about THC is that's probably the most common part of the plant that people are familiar with, largely because it's the psychoactive portion where it binds to the area of the brain that gives you that euphoria or high, which is why people use it for recreational purposes. Completely separate chemical structure are things like CBD and et cetera. So Abby, with CBD, how would we differentiate that?
Right, so CBD doesn't have the psychoactive components. It interacts with different areas in your body, and so you don't get that high that you typically think of with cannabis. The cannabis plant has over 100 of these different substances in them. THC, CBD are just two of the most common ones, but each one does something different. So when you think of cannabis, most people do think of THC, but then you have other compounds that you can isolate, like CBD, and then we get medicine and treatments for epilepsy and other conditions that way.
And I think the important thing is that they're not interchangeable.
That is a perfect point to lead us to a summary at this time. And what I've asked is that each of our panelists to kind of your main take-home point in terms of when we're talking about the history as well as the terminology. And I'll start with Anup.
I think the biggest thing I'd like for us to take away is that this isn't a new movement. This has been here for a long period of time. We've just gotten to now a point where things have really gotten to where we can actually give this to humans and make a medication. That then went through the FDA process. But it obviously took a long time for us to get here. Although the studies were done very quickly and the results were interpreted really quickly, and then the DEA, in our opinion, made a quick determination, it's been ongoing.
That's a great, great summary. Barry.
So I think this whole issue of clarifying what we're talking about, I mean, you know, we need to have a common lexicon. We need to have a common language that we all understand. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking between, you know, patients, between patient providers, that we understand what we're talking about. So again, an edible or medical marijuana, realize that there's a lot of variability in what we're discussing.
Very, very important point as well. Alice.
Well, I certainly agree with Anup about, we've known about historically the therapeutic potential of these molecules for a long time. But unlike opiates that began to be developed for modern medicine in the 1800s, cannabinoids are hard to research, they're hard to formulate, they're hard to administer. So there's just been an absence of technology, which leads us to sort of a gap of almost like 100 years between the development of opiates and now the development of modern cannabinoids. But technology is here now, so I expect to see a lot of these products available in the future.
Such a good point. Abby.
I guess just echoing what everyone else has said, that now that there is an FDA-approved medication, you know, it went through the same process as other treatments, and, you know, this isn't a new age drug. It's not that somebody woke up in this century and thought, we're going to take this illegal drug and turn it into medicine just because I want to use it. And then I would also echo that I think there's a real need for us to have common terminology when we talk about this. And I also think it's important to touch on specifically cannabis versus marijuana and the terms used. I know sometimes people think of them as two different plants or two different substances. Cannabis is, you know, sort of the medical, whereas marijuana, that's the dangerous drug. And it's really important to note that cannabis is part of the name of the plant. It's part of the genus. It's the scientific name. And marijuana is just a slang term for cannabis that really came about in the early part of the 1900s when they were working to outlaw cannabis as well as other drugs that was part of the marijuana tax. And I think if we start getting everyone on the same terminology that way, then it's a nice starting point for us to go into further research and broader conversations about this.
Abby, thank you for that wonderful point. And I think this is a perfect time to thank all of our wonderful panelists that joined us for the discussion today. That included Anup, Barry, Alice, Abby, and you all, the viewer. My name is Dr. Joe Sirven, Editor-in-Chief of Epilepsy.com, and you've been watching the Epilepsy Foundation's discussion on cannabidiol for epilepsy. Thanks so much for joining us today.